Welcome. In today's video, I'll be taking you through the steps I take while creating, building, and testing my rocket motors. I hope you learn a thing or two from this video. This video will also include some sneak peeks of SN4 and what I'm currently working on. It all starts with design. Before I start drawing anything in CAD, I create a general goal that I want to accomplish. For SN1, the goal was to build a functional rocket and learn techniques for casting propellant and simply see if it works. For SN2, I focus on increasing reliability of the nozzle and also increasing the total mass of the propellant. For SN3, the goal was to push the design to its limits by increasing the total mass of the propellant and significantly cutting the mass of the casing. For SN4, the aim is to combine all data from previous motors and create a reliable and reusable design. There is a slight twist, but I'll save it for the SN4 video. Once I establish the goals for the motors, I begin drawing some sketches on paper to get my thoughts out. These sketches then evolve into detailed CAD drawings for precise planning and manufacturing. Let's start with the design of the nozzle. For my motor, I use a traditional converging-diverging nozzle. This nozzle design helps accelerate the flow of gases escaping the motor, maximizing thrust. I use a software tool called Open Motor, which allows me to input my parameters of my motor and adjust them to predict performance. After finalizing the geometry, it's time to select a material to make the nozzle out of. There are many options, including graphite, aluminum, and stainless steel, each with their own advantages and disadvantages. For SN1, I used aluminum, but the low melting point became a problem when chamber pressures rose too high. Aluminum might work great if reusability isn't a priority, or your motor chamber pressure stays relatively low. For SN3, I used stainless steel. While heavier, it was extremely durable and allowed for reuse, with no visible damage after every static fire. The nozzle must also include an O-ring or multiple O-rings to seal all the gases in. Believe it or not, the small rubber O-ring is one of the most important components of the motor. This O-ring prevents hot gases from escaping and destroying your motor. When selecting an O-ring, it is important to choose one with a high durameter to ensure it seals effectively. I use 75A. Too soft, the O-ring might not hold up. Too hard, it may not compress enough to seal. Careful consideration is needed for the groove placement to ensure the O-ring penetrates just far enough outwards to make a tight seal with the casing. The bulkhead is simpler compared to the nozzle, but just as crucial. Its main purpose is to stop hot gases from escaping through the aft end of the motor. It's typically a solid chunk of aluminum with grooves for the O-ring and holes for the bolts. The bulkhead can also serve as a mounting point for other components such as a pressure transducer. In SN4, I have added a pressure transducer to monitor internal pressures. I used a 1/8 inch MPT thread for a pressure transducer because the threads are tapered. This is very important because the tapered nature of the threads stop gases from escaping through the threads. The casing I use is aluminum, purchased online and cut to the required length. The casing serves as a structural backbone, holding the propellant, nozzle, and bulkhead securely in place. Some people worry and say the heat inside the motor gets too hot for my aluminum casing, but most of the cardboard tube stays intact. Once I finalize the CAD designs, it's time to manufacture these parts. You can either manufacture the parts yourself or outsource them to a machine shop. I personally outsource because I don't have access to a lathe or any tools needed for precise machining. There are many websites out there that can produce high quality parts quickly, affordably, and within high tolerance. Securing the nozzle and bulkhead is a critical step in the motor assembly process. There are different methods to do this, such as snap rings, bolts, or other retention systems. I use bolts. They offer a secure and reliable connection. The bolt holes in the nozzle and bulkhead are pre-drilled and threaded by the manufacturer, but I designed a custom jig to transfer these holes onto the casing accurately. This ensures precise alignment, which is essential for successful assembly. For SN1, I used a band of paper to locate the areas to drill the holes. Although it worked, the holes were not that precise, leading to issues when assembling because the nozzle could only be in one orientation to line up all the bolts. Be sure to calculate and ensure the holes in the casing are drilled far enough away from the edge of the wall, or else you may have a rud. Next step is casting the propellant. Selecting the right fuel is very important. I use a relatively safe and easy to source fuel, rocket candy. Rocket candy uses sugar as the fuel and potassium nitrate as the oxidizer. After many tests, I've settled on a formula that includes sorbitol, two different mesh sizes of potassium nitrate, and red iron oxide to accelerate the reaction. Casting the propellant has by far been the most challenging part of the process, but it is refined now. I cast the propellant into a cardboard tube that fits perfectly in the aluminum casing. I use a custom designed plate to hold the cardboard tube in place and center the silicone tube running down the middle. At the bottom of the silicone tubing, a finicil section fits into it. Here's the top plate, which also helps center the silicone tubing. The silicone tube is reinforced with a 1/4 inch bolt to maintain rigidity. The finicil also has a tapered end to fit perfectly within the silicone tubing. To minimize air bubbles, I pour the propellant in small batches rather than all at once. While some recommend using a vacuum chamber to suck out bubbles, Rocket Candy's short work time after heating makes this impractical. For improved ignition reliability, I add a thin layer of black powder inside the grain. This modification was made after the mishap with SN3. Assembling the rocket is straightforward. I start by bolting the bulkhead in using plastic washers to prevent the screw heads from denting the casing. Next, I insert the propellant and then secure the nozzle the same way as the bulkhead. Once the motor is fully assembled, it's time to test. The motor is mounted to a test stand made by 2x6 wood with a hole down the center to hold the motor. These holes are slightly larger than the motor diameter, so I add shims for a snug fit. Currently, the test stand is disassembled and getting major upgrades for SN4's first test. A load cell mounted to the test stand is placed below the motor to record thrust. This data is outputted to an Arduino that is close by and saved to an SD card. The load cell is protected by heat with an insulation block. For SN4, I am upgrading the test stand to include a load cell adapter for better support for a pressure transducer and a load cell. Remote ignition is handled by a modified rocket igniter with a long underground conduit added for safety. This makes setup much easier to handle, especially in adverse weather conditions like rain and mud. I also have a full video on my test site setup. Click the link above to watch. After each test, I gather all the data and take detailed pictures of the motor. Revision is one of the most important parts of the process. Analyzing the results, identifying issues, and iterating on designs ensures constant improvement. For example, after SN3's failure, SN4's bolt holes will be positioned further from the end of the casing. I kept the end of the video to include some photos I haven't shared before, showing the motor of what it looks like after a static fire prior to being clean. Once the testing is complete, I ensure the area is safe before immediately conducting temperature tests on the motor. After the motor cools down, I remove from its test stand and begin disassembly. Here's a picture of SM1 fully assembled after testing. As you can see, the heat stickers are fully maxed out near the nozzle area. Here's a picture of SM1's diverging side of the nozzle. As you can see the slag buildup, this is easy to remove with just some water. And here's the converging side, the side inside the motor. Here's a picture of the bulkhead. Here's a picture of SN2 fully assembled after a test. Just like SM1, these heat stickers are maxed out as well. Here's a picture of the aft end of SN2. As you can see the washers melted. That's okay, because they're pretty cheap and I just replace them every test. Here's a picture of SN2's stainless steel nozzle insert. This side was facing inside of the motor. And this side was facing the opposite way. The coloring on the stainless steel is really cool. SN2 had an issue during its first two tests with the primary O-ring developing tears. This is a serious problem because if one of those O-rings failed, the entire motor would have been destroyed. After the second static fire, I discovered the cause was that one of the bolt holes in the casing had a small lip that was tearing the O-rings when the bulkhead was inserted. For SN3's third test, I tried experimenting with some fuel additives. This created a cool puck of slag at the aft end of the motor, which I later chipped out. Here's SN3's nozzle after its first test. Even though these O-rings are rated for high temperature, they still melted quite a bit. This is a major issue, because the melting happened well after the motor has completed its test fire. Here's a video of the casing from SN3's second test. The aluminum really stretched and gave out, shooting the nozzle into the air. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe, comment, and like. And if you would like to support my work, you can buy me a cup of coffee. Link is in the description. Thank you.